it's sort of quirky. It's not intended to be any deep symbolism or anything like that. The giant chicken is eating a bug, you know. Okay, so
there's the bug.
There's the bug, and the bug is life size, VW.
Oh yeah, yes, it is.
True
it
size.
Is.
Yeah.
And one of the wonderful things about this is that we have a neighbor on the street who is this is her vehicle, 1972 pristine orange VW Beetle, and it made perfect sense for this.
Welcome to Peak Moment. I'm Janaea Donaldson. I'm in Victoria West at a street called McCaskill. That looks like any other residential street, but it sure doesn't act like it. I'm with Patty Parkhouse and Jack Meredith, who instigated a project with, what, transition towns for your street? Is that right?
That's correct, yep.
How did it get started?
It was a pilot project out of Transition Victoria. I heard about it through email, Jack heard about it through email, and being neighbors, we came together and said, let's do it.
Yeah, do right, what?
We found out almost the same day.
Really?
I was at the BC Sustainable Energy Society meeting, and Patty was at another meeting, and we came together to try to sell each other on this idea, and it wasn't hard to sell.
So what was the germ of the idea? What was the intention of that project?
It was bringing neighbors together and teaching them ways to transition their lives off their dependency on oil, basically. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there was five themes. It was waste, water, transition, or transportation, food, energy.
That's a good set.
Is that five? That's five.
So is that about educating neighbors about that or doing ways of sharing? I mean, what do you do those themes?
There was a booklet. It was based on a program out of England. So McCaskill Street was the first street in North America to do this pilot.
Congratulations.
Yeah, so yeah. There was actually a handbook, and there was different chapters, and we so there was a section on each theme, and we read that over, and then we would meet, and there was discussion at the meeting. So, and we rotated in different people's houses. So
when you say meet, what you did is did you just knock on doors to invite your neighbors to come do mm-hmm. this? Is that?
Well, that was the thing that was most appealing to me. I always wanted to live in a neighborhood where I knew my neighbors mm-hmm. well enough to go to anybody on the street and ask for a cup of sugar.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew Patty, and I knew a couple of other people that I felt that comfortable with. But I saw the promise in what the program has, as Transition Victoria laid it out. To be able to go to people with this program that they already had and knock on the doors with Patty mm-hmm. and say, look at this neat program, we can do these things that Patty just described. And at the end of it, they've got some funding for a minor project. So for me, that was the Trojan horse. That was the way that I could easily go and knock on the people's doors without any kind of fear. It wasn't me saying, you don't know me, but I want to be your new best friend. You know, it was a nice, easy way to introduce people to the program.
Important thing to do, breaking down those barriers that we have amongst each other, even if you live near each other, is we all have these isolated little lives.
Exactly.
And you've been dissolving that. So what kind of response did you get?
Great response. Yeah.
Yeah, we went to 16 doors, I think I counted at one point in time, and 16 out of 16 loved the idea, embraced the idea, and I think at the initial meeting, I think we had 12 of the 16 mm-hmm. households represented, mm-hmm. and most of those 12 have now carried on with the various potluck meetings that we had, and then I've moved into action, and I think I can go to any of those 16 houses now and ask for a cup of sugar. So I'm over the top
yes,
happy.
You know? That's right. You said that at the end there was there was funding for a project. Did I understand you right?
That That was a promise up front, and okay. the funding was there, but we never actually got to a big project. I think you did some minor projects.
We got some metal recycle bins because the school was having a metal recycle program to raise money, so we got a couple of those for the coordinator, and we bought a couple of plastic garbage cans mm-hmm. that people turned into digesters for waste.
Oh, okay.
Yep, so that was kind of around the themes. Not everybody wanted one, mm-hmm. so... Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was a few of us that used the money for that. I think there was about $500.
Oh, that's yeah. Nice.
But we've gone on to do other things since then. So
like,
The mural that's behind
yes,
you.
Yes, yes.
Continue to have. We continued on with. A few of us had chickens at that time, and so now there's more coops on the street, and we built relationships around those coops. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And
all of the ignamblers.
Yes, the ignamblers.
Well, we will. We will. Get to tour some of yep. what you've done.
So absolutely. Then,
yep.
Great. Mm. Let's do it.
Okay. If we were to do it over again, I would love the project to be a well. I think we need a McCaskill Street well.
Aha. Uh-huh. Everybody to come for their cup of water.
Their cup of water.
Instead of a gallon of water.
In times of need, if we live in an earthquake zone, if the infrastructure gets disturbed, it would be nice to have our own water source.
Yes. All right. We'll come back in a couple of years and you can give us a tour of the well.
Perfect. Okay.
Let's go see some of the other parts of what McCaskill Street folks have done.
Okay. All right.
I'm with Lori Garcia Meredith, who's an artist behind a wonderful, creative, colorful mural.
Well, thank you.
How did this get started?
It was a community effort, actually. We needed to apply for a community grant in order to really make this happen, mm-hmm. just in mm-hmm. terms of getting the funds for the paint and all that kind of thing. And because there are deadlines for grants, it really actually made it happen.
Good.
So once we knew that we got the grant money, we went for it. And we have until actually only 2 more weeks mm-hmm. to finish.
Mm-hmm. But we're close.
You're well along.
It
looks like
here.
We're going to make it, yeah.
So whose property is this that you have permission to do that?
It's actually private property. It belongs mm-hmm. to the neighbors above here and there. There's 2 properties. And they were totally supportive mm-hmm. of the whole project. Mm-hmm. And the grant that we applied for actually required that you have at least 8 families as part of the grant,
okay.
so that you had to have cooperation amongst a whole bunch of neighbors and their support and actually their participation. So we all got together and decided what kinds of things we'd want for a design. I went away and figured out a whole bunch of designs. Mm-hmm. Presented them back to the crowd, and this one was pretty much the winning one.
Hey. Well, tell us the themes in here, because this is a fascinating long stretch here.
Right, it is. Okay. the irony of the design, actually, is that when we had our brainstorming session about ideas that we wanted, it was almost a throwaway line from Patty's son. He said, we should just have a giant chicken eating a Westphalia. And because we have a lot of Westphalias on the street as well. We have a lot of chicken love, so it kind of all made sense. So I put together this design, and he hadn't actually said that. He'd said a chicken driving a Westphalia, but the eating a Westphalia made everybody laugh. And it was kind of the best of brainstorming, where a whole bunch mm-hmm. of ideas get presented mm-hmm. and a misunderstanding actually comes up with the best idea.
I love it. Is that it's like you let the creative process. It wasn't any one person with it.
That's sort of a beautiful testament to a group.
Exactly.
Process,
exactly.
Know, creative process.
Yeah. But then someone said, you know, it doesn't make more sense for chickens to eat bugs. So this made sense as well.
Fabulous.
Yeah. And it's been impressive about people who have just been driving by, and they'll stop and say, thank you for making such a colorful mural, or I love it, and it's not mm. any one demographic. We have the biker dudes coming by going, yeah, you know, and everybody's really into it. So it's been really rewarding in that fashion.
Strikes me that what you're doing is making very visible in this one form how your whole street is starting to ferment,
right.
you know, a community among yourselves.
Oh, right. Absolutely. And you're not in Kansas anymore.
No, we're not.
Despite the chicken.
Patty, you mentioned there was a food component in the transition workbook, stuff that you do with your neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
So talk
mm-hmm.
to me about that and what you've done around that.
Well, on the street, we have started to reclaim some of the boulevards. So the one that we're sitting on now, I mentioned it to the neighbor. This boulevard was just a bunch of blackberries and weeds and scrub. And he was looking for a place to get rid of some waste wood and some waste soil because he was doing some excavating. So I just mentioned it to him. I said, well, you know, it'd be great to reclaim this boulevard and put in a growing bed that we could share amongst the neighbors. So within a couple days, we built it, and this is its second season.
Well, somebody over there is obviously very happy, even though we're even in this harvest time. Yeah. I mean, the size of this is just astounding.
So was is the food you? I mean, you see squash. So you raised edibles.
Yep.
Here.
Yep. Yeah, we just harvested the potatoes last weekend. Uh-huh. Yeah, there were some kids walking by who'd never knew where a potato came. They were with their family, so they stopped and helped us. Potato, and we dug them up.
So what did you do with the food?
We shared it. I gave some to Jamie. I kept some, and I think I gave a couple to Jack and
the little
and
Laurie. Kids. Yeah. Who got to have their potatoes. That's great.
Mm-hmm.
That's great.
Yeah. So I bought the seed potatoes. And Jamie planted them, and he watered them. He lives up there, and we all kind of share them.
That's great. Mm-hmm. I like that. You've also got something that you call a community orchard.
Yep. That's another boulevard that I guerrilla gardened with a local project called Life Cycles.
Let's go take a look.
Okay.
I'll go with you. Patty, you're... Boulevard orchard is really a wonderful, plentiful piece. What all do you have here that you've planted?
Well, we have some fruit trees, apple trees, pear, plum, fig trees, some different types of berry bushes. And in the summer, neighbors come and plant potatoes and squash and tomatoes and whatever they want to plant.
Who waters this?
I do. Some of the other neighbors do. We get the water from a neighbor right close to the orchard. Just drag the hose across the street and
makes it easy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's larger than I envisioned when I thought about a community orchard. What do you do with the fruit?
People come by and pick. Not just people who take care of it, but people walking by. Mm-hmm. Like the Spartan tree behind you, it had about 6 apples, and I was hoping to get one, but I didn't get any. But that's okay. That's why it's here.
Somebody did.
Yeah, somebody did.
Yep. Well, that's nice. Mm-hmm. It looks to me that not only are you growing things, but even the orchard is sort of spreading.
It is, yeah.
I'm with Jack Meredith. Thanks for joining me again. And another neighbor, Warren Walsh. Thanks for joining me. You two got involved with, well, you and your neighborhood got involved with energy concerns. How did that start out?
Well, that was part of the series of meetings we held, and one of our neighbors, Janet, held a meeting on energy use. And we had an energy auditor come in and give us a discussion about all the different rebates that are available, some of the different things we could do in our homes, and that led to a bunch of neighbors getting together or individually going out then and getting audits done on their own homes, and resulted in a lot of basically equipment being purchased.
Like what?
Heat pumps, insulation.
Wait, what's a heat pump? Other than, you said that's a heat pump?
That's a heat pump.
What does that...
What
does it do?
It's basically like a refrigerator for your house that's hooked up backwards.
Wait a minute. A refrigerator for your house that's hooked up backwards.
Yeah, so it's taking heat from outside, just in the air, and it's taking that heat and moving it into your house.
As heat.
As heat.
So you get heat. So yes. it's a warmer. It's a warmer.
Yeah, it's a warmer. It's a type of home heating unit.
And so were there rebates for installing these instead of what else?
There were a series of rebates that were available from the provincial government, from the federal government, even our local electricity provider, BC Hydro, and many of us really didn't know about what the rebates were, how much they were for. So that was a good reason to get neighbors together to talk about what was available, what we could save, and how much it would cost, what the paybacks would be. So
Yeah,
it was a real eye-opener for me. Janet hosted the meeting and had the auditor, and like Warren said, but the reality at the end of the day is that the rebates paid for a large part of the percent of putting in the heat pumps in our various houses. Yeah, it was really fabulous. And this technology, now you've got this unit outside, like Warren's saying, is if it was on, it would be making us cold here. Well, it's making the house warm inside. And the unit inside Warren's house here is not a lot bigger than a bread box. It's maybe 30 inches by 10 inches by 10 inches. It's really, really pretty small.
So that gave you, so part of it is saving energy for heating, right? Were there any other aspects of that that your group came around to with other energy savings?
Well, overall, that's huge part.
Sure.
You know, these units, many of the houses here and in this part of the city or in this part of the province are heated either with oil or with electric baseboards.
Okay.
So my house went from electric baseboards to this type of unit, so we saw a 30% reduction in power use just from switching to this type of unit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We also changed a few windows and doors. Those were all covered at the time.
Okay, because that would be, conservate insulation or double windows and stuff. Those are all the things you could do.
Yes.
Similarly, we put in a heat pump at our house, just a little brother to this one here. Plus, we did insulation down in our crawl space, tightened the house overall, and installed some double and, in fact, one triple glazed window on our house. And we reduced our energy use by like 60%.
Fabulous.
So, 1,500 square foot house that only uses $500 a year in total energy. It's all electric, so. We're pleased as punch.
Absolutely. So, and I'm tickled that you did that as a neighborhood. I mean, you learned about it together as a neighborhood, so you could talk to each other about, compare notes on things.
Exactly. So, as we individually got new information, going from knowing absolutely nothing about these particular types of units, you'd get a little bit of information. We started sharing it, and in the end, I think there's four houses that had these particular types of heat pumps installed, and that's a pretty decent adoption rate for out of 10 really houses.
Great. Yeah. Anything else with the energy front that I haven't asked you about?
Well, I guess it's also expanded past just our street too, as a number of people come and have this kind of conversation. And I know of several houses have also gone and got energy audits and have had heat pumps installed in them too. So that's really gratifying too.
It's like what Patty said to me about the gardens. If you plant a carrot, and other carrots are going to grow. It expands. It's like your discussion, your meeting, spread not only to your street but elsewhere. And I hope it goes even further.
Yeah. And one thing that hasn't been accomplished yet, but we looked at just a minute ago, is a little experiment that I've got going with regards to photovoltaic cells that will directly heat domestic hot water. So
not part of the grid at all.
That's right. Yeah. That little piece of my house will be off the grid without having to go to the solar thermal kind of system where you've got pumps and water and all that complication. It's a direct PV to domestic water.
To a little heating unit, right?
That's right.
Good for you.
That's part of what I really like about the street is when I've got a crazy idea, I can call Warren or Patty or some of the others and just sort of say, what do you think? What can we do? And actually, we just as we're getting set up here, we're just walking past some experiments that Warren's doing too, in a similar vein with regards to building some electric bikes in his shop back here. So all sorts of neat things that people are doing, but if we hadn't had the street and didn't sort of get into one another's backyards into their sheds.
It's all those conversations. All of the electric bike parts I have is from a conversation that came from me talking with Jack, and he said, I know somebody. And over about a month and a half, we suddenly were able to get used, basically broken electric bikes, and I've gotten one running again on a new frame. So it's sort of reusing old gear that people throw away things a little too quickly in our society.
Yes.
And things do need to be fixed. So.
And maybe that's the segue just to the fact that we can borrow lots of things from one another.
Mm-hmm.
The concept of a tool library always kind of concerned me, because if you put tools into a common space, the tragedy of the commons, that nobody would take care of them.
Yes.
But now we really have a tool library on the whole street. I know Warren has a drill press now that I'm going to...
You're eyeing that drill press,
Well,
huh?
no, I, I'm not coveting a drill press anymore because I've got one. And Warren's storing it for me.
So your tool sharing, what you're talking about here, is not a place, but relationships.
It's relationships, exactly. Yeah, and the drill press was a funny one. It was someone who actually called me because they wanted to have the drill press taken and thrown into the metal recycling and, you know, wanted help with getting it into metal recycling and wanted the money for that metal recycling to go to the local school. So we've done that before where we get metal recycling for money. But I saw a working drill press and I said, well, I'll just tuck that into the back here and we'll see if it works and get it cleaned up. I cleaned it up. And it has done a couple of jobs, but I haven't actually used it for a job myself, for my own projects. It's been other people that have come by and had to do a little project. You need a drill press, someone will know, Warren has one. You can go visit him and he'll help.
Are there other tools that people feel comfortable lending out to their neighbors?
One that relates to the energy meeting that we had, as we're talking about energy, we're talking about the use of gasoline for garden tools, lawn mowing. We had a gas lawnmower, and Laurie expressed a concern about, do we have to have that loud, stinky,
fossil fuel driven
way to cut our lawn? Wouldn't it be more efficient and fit our values better to have an electric one? And I kind of agreed with that, but didn't action it. And then Patty shows up about a month later with this lawnmower saying, here's the street lawnmower, can you store it at your place? So
an electric lawnmower.
Electric lawnmower, yeah. So Patty was listening more than I was, apparently. and now I store it the same as Warren stores the drill press that we have.
So you've got you've each got a community shareable tool.
And Jamie has the cement mixer, and Stuart has the orchard ladder. It's delightful.
And
everybody has the cup of sugar.
Yes, your story about sharing, feeling like you can borrow. What I hear is a lot of trust has been built up among you, and more sharing together of information. You have an email list, so you can... Somebody mentioned, an email list. I need a hairdryer or whatever, something overnight. It's like, it just shows up,
Laurie's going to a costume party, and she needed her hair all curled up, so she put out a call for a curling iron.
Is that what it was?
And it's amazing how many people still have curling irons. But the last frontier that we haven't got over is borrowing Westphalias. Like, many of us have Westphalias.
I see.
But, it's... There are limits to trust, and
that's because they're always broken, Jack.
Well, since you have a Westphalia, and you have a Westphalia, and we have a Westphalia, I understand they're a little bit of a home for you, and they are idiosyncratic and
they have a personality.
That too. Like you go, thank you. It's good energy, tools. Information, resources, but not yet the Westphalians. They continue spreading. I'm in the backyard, Janet Riddell's backyard. Thanks for joining me with Warren Walsh, with Jack Meredith. And you are all part of what you call a coop, which really is
co-op.
Like a coop, co-op, but it looks like coop. A shared cooperative, all of you with chickens?
Yes.
How this gets started.
I'd always wanted to have chickens for many, many years, and I had a coop in my yard, and neighbors were interested, and eventually my birds were getting older and weren't producing as many eggs, especially in the winter, and so it became an idea, well, you need to have more chickens around, and so, I saw a large yard in the back of Janet's house, and not enough chickens in it. As in no chickens.
Oh!
No chickens. No. No chickens. And he kept coming over and kind of sizing my yard up. But anyway, I was eventually persuaded, because I really always wanted to have them too, but I didn't know what it would entail. And so finally he made me an offer. I couldn't refuse it. I'll do everything. I'll build, all the parts and all the materials, and I'll buy the feed.
and you just have to have the yard, and you can have as many eggs as you want. And after a while, I started to realize that maybe there was not really much of a downside that I could.
So did that happen? I mean,
Yeah, I didn't do anything. I just sat here like a landlord and watched while Warren and Jack and Lori did all the work and built this. So
and we had a perspective that if we just, you know, painted a few boards and helped build the coop, we could get some free eggs.
I get it. Did it happen?
Well, what happened is we saw these guys having so much fun with their chickens and with the process, we thought, we've got to see them. We've got to have chickens, too. So we ended up building a coop halfway through the process.
Oh, I love it.
The other part of the story is that they had some of the eggs that were hatching that Warren couldn't hatch them all, or he couldn't look after them all, so they took some.
And we ended up hatching them in our oven, so we were.
And then they fell in love with them, and they couldn't.
I get it. I get it.
And they thought that my
bonded with your little chicks.
Well, that's exactly the truth. You get these little chicks, and how could you give that up at the end of the day?
Even across the street, too, a trusted neighbor, it still was not good enough for their chicks. I'm not offended.
I forgot that part.
So how many? So you've got chick. How many coops do you have now? We've got three. I hear three.
There's four. There's four coops in this immediate area. Now we do a chicken tour every spring, where we take people that just want to see chickens and see what's involved. And this year we walked all over the neighborhood. I think we went to see 7 or 8 different coops, and some coops we had to, they were too far out of the way. So we're not the only ones.
That's
but
exciting.
I think this is certainly the highest density of chickens in the neighborhood.
You're chicken. That's great. Chickens and eggs. So you're partly it's food security,
yep.
Partly it's just
quality, and also neighborliness.
I would guess,
and also help with chicken sitters. That's a big issue.
I was wondering about that,
because all of us like to travel and go away and go camping and stuff, and so we it's nice to have other people in the neighborhood that can pitch in and know how to look after birds.
Right. I was wondering that you can do that.
That was a huge part for us too.
That's where the egg-nabling comes in.
Yeah, egg-nabling. Wait a minute. Egg-nabling.
Egg-nabling.
We're the egg-nablers.
Egg-nablers.
Egg-nablers. Yeah, it's a term to encompass getting other people comfortable with having chickens, getting them, you know, to have a coop in their yard or take part in somebody's coop, and then also the day-to-day operations. If, you know, someone's going away, the emails are, can you egg-nable for me this week?
I love it.
I'm going away.
I love it. Don't you want to be an egg-nabler in your neighborhood? I think this is a grand idea. You're watching Peak Moment. I'm Janaea Donaldson, and I'm with a couple of the folks that live on McCaskill Street, where neighborliness is becoming something wonderful. Join us next time.